Guys, what's going on?
Yo, Tim, you know who's going to be on today's show?
Yeah, Lacey Sturm from Flyleaf.
Tim, do you know what that means?
It means they're going to have a really great show.
No, Tim, this means it could be a huge opportunity for us.
A huge opportunity? Guys, you know she does, like, serious rock and roll, like progressive metal.
Tim, absolutely, and we could be a part of her band.
But really?
Tim, we got to go get some gear, though.
Let's go to the mall.
Guys, we got a live show to do. Where are you going?
The idea that his musicians left him before the show stopped him from starting the show. Your host of Nightlife, Tim Bergen.
Ladies and gentlemen, the smooth and smart Sydney, and about now I would be saying the twins, Kurt and Kellen, but they seem to be having a bit of an identity crisis right now, thinking that they want to be rock stars rather than being here for the open of the show. Well, we'll find him somewhere. We always have a theme for the show, and it seems like this week's is particularly appropriate, as it is identity. Now, the dictionary defines identity this way. It's a condition or character as to who a person or what a thing is. The qualities, beliefs, etc., that distinguish or identify a person or thing. Now, I hadn't lived with my parents for nearly 30 years when my dad passed, and we moved my mom in with us. Yet, despite the fact that the weather's bad, my mom will still say, well, do you have a warm coat? Or stay warm out there, or be careful driving. See, one of my identities, and the most important one to my mom, is being her son. But I'm a husband, a father, a brother, a friend, a pastor, a mentor, a teacher, a student, a child of God, an overcomer, and so much more. See, it's how people know us and what we think of ourselves. God has called us and given us an identity for our blessing. What if you don't know or grab on to the way that God sees us? Our identity is both determined by us and is kind of thrust upon us by others. What if that identity is broken? What if you're trapped in an identity that is really not who you are? Lacey Sturm, artist and rising star in the music scene, is here with us today. You may know her from the band Flyleaf, or from working with Billy Graham, or many other musical endeavors, but before all the joy and all the blessings, there was another side of life that Lacey knew all too well, a side that many of the millennial generation have gone through. You may be there right now, or you may know someone that is there right now. This is a must-see show. Well, at least Sydney and I will see it. The twins, well, they still aren't back. So, Robin, do we have some canned music to take us to the break? Okay, good, we're good. Well, we'll be right back after this canned music with Lacey Sturm.
All right, Kat. Well, I'm thinking, hey, man, since Lacey's gonna be here, we gotta make sure we bring our A game. And there's only one way to bring it, and that's karaoke style. Hit it, y'all.
Young man, there's no need to feel down. I said, young man, pick yourself off the ground. Young man, 'cause you're running the town. There's no need to be unhappy. On the road again. I just can't wait to get on the road again. It's fun to stay at the YMCA. It's fun to stay at the YMCA. Don't stop believing, hold on to that feeling, and I can't wait to get on the road again.
Yeehaw!
I think we got it, kid. I think too, partner. I think Lacey's gonna be blown away. She definitely will be now.
Woo! And I can't wait to get on the road again.
Ah!
rock princess, wife, mom, and daughter of the king, welcome with me, Lacey Sturm. Lacey, come on down. It's so good to see you. Oh, it's great to see you. You know what? I got to be honest with you. You're tinier than I thought. When I see you on the videos, it's like, wow, she's amazing. But you know what? It is so. I'm so glad to have you here. Your story should never happen to anybody. What you walked through should never happen to anyone. Well, you're famous now. People know you. They know all. You know, they see you and they see your videos, things like that. But life wasn't always this fairy tale life that you're living now.
Right. That's funny. Thinking about the journey has been unbelievable that, you know, I think about it a lot. I wake up in the morning and it's crazy to think that that used to be the worst moment of my day, was just realizing, oh, I have to do life again. You know, I didn't die last night. And then realizing I wake up and I hear my kids laughing and I'm like, oh, I can't wait to see them. You know, like, life is so different.
When, in your first book, The Reason How I Discovered a Life Worth Living, you talk about your story. You talk about the brokenness of growing up more or less with a single mom. Your mm-hmm. your stepdads were in and were out. Mm-hmm. And it was a hopeless situation. There's a lot of people in this culture now that are in that situation. Mm-hmm. How did you weave through?
You know, I didn't really feel like I fit in with the church community because I know the story of, you know, you should be married and have kids and all this stuff. And I always felt sort of like, well, I'm not those people. So who am I? You know, I'm these other people that sort of have to be embarrassed about or ashamed or whatever. But my mom, she was just so strong. And she just knew who she was. You know, she knew about God. And she said, you know, God is going to take care of us no matter what anybody else thinks. And so she always did talk to me about God. And she has her own story of overcoming that made her so strong. I think that's why she was really tough on us. You know, she didn't let us complain too often. Although I felt really sorry for myself most of my childhood. And I struggled with self-loathing and self-pity and depression, deep depression. So I think the way that we got through it was that, especially when I went through writing my first book, God started showing me how he was with me through all of those things. And I remember thinking, how am I going to write about this? It's so heavy. But even when I went back to remember, he would show me moments of joy and moments of provision and moments of just overcoming. And it's just really his story in the end.
But Lacey, any one of the things, going through having an alcoholic father, an abusive situation in the household, seeing what your family went through, living in an apartment with all of you in this cramped little apartment, any one of those things would have sent anybody else down the road to saying, you know, I hate God. I mean, in some way, with the tragedy of your nephew,
my cousin,
that did send you down that road. But how did God weave you through all that stuff? Because we've got people that are watching that are just have gone through one of those things, and they never want to think about God
right.
ever again.
Well, I did feel that way, and I totally understand that feeling of, you know, people talk to me about God and you get angry and you're like, well, that's a broken chair. Why would you tell me to sit in that? It's not even, you know, it made me angry when people would, you know, talk about trusting God and my cousin's beaten to death by his stepfather. Where was God for him? You know, just things like, and then you start to notice it everywhere. You know, the enemy wants you to, he wants you to have, to destroy you. He wants you to despair. And always, you know, it's a funny thing because I used to meditate on sad things. And I remember later on when I became a Christian reading, think on things that are lovely and, you know, and pure and righteous and all the good things. There are so many good things to see. But when we have this habit of just this, there's a comfort in an addiction almost that you get when you are always sad and always in drama and always in, you know, there, you get addicted to the adrenaline of fighting with people and always arguing. And then you also get addicted to the sadness that comes after and feeling sorry for yourself. And I really did. If I didn't have anything to be sad about, I would just think about things to be sad about, and I would cry myself to sleep every night. I couldn't sleep unless I cried myself to sleep.
What was growing up? What was your identity? What was your image? Who were you?
I was a burden, another mouth to feed, and always trying to make as little impact as I had to, you know? So, oh, nobody noticed me. I just be as quiet as I can so I don't get in trouble and I don't cause any problems. And try, and at school, you know, I don't want anybody to make fun of me, you know, don't see me, you know, because I have these, you know, my brothers hand me down thrift store clothes and you get made fun of and you get bullied. And so that's kind of what I felt like, just kind of like, I wish I could just disappear most of the time. And that was my identity, just a burden, you know.
You didn't have, like I said earlier, that kind of father figure in your life, but one of your key things in your new book, The Mystery, Finding True Love in a World of Broken Lovers, is recognizing you're a daughter.
Yes.
How did that change who you are?
Well, the difference between being an orphan, which that's kind of what I felt like. It was like, even though I had a mom and I had people in and out of my life that were like father figures, my mom also had a broken story. And she taught me, no one's gonna take care of you, you take care of yourself. You know, you have to provide, you have to make a way, you have to never believe or trust anybody on face value. You know, you gotta be smarter than that, nothing's for free. You know, this orphan mentality of it's all on you, you know? And if you're not smarter than them, they're gonna outsmart you. It's just a street mentality of having walls with everybody because they'll hurt you if you don't.
It protects you. Mm-hmm. It protects you. Apart from Christ, it protects you.
Yeah. And don't trust somebody to take care of you. You gotta do it. You know, you gotta kind of, it's like a hustle. You gotta hustle. And you gotta like, just always be smarter and be tough because don't let them hurt you where they can see it, you know, kind of thing. And that's kind of what I felt. But then when there were these relationships that would come that I connected with, I would just make it everything. Oh, this is my God. This is my life source. This is the thing I've always looked for and needed. And you feel like when you connect with that relationship you haven't had, you come to life in ways you never came to life, and you feel like this is it. And that's kind of how I went through those bad romantic relationships where I just thought, oh, this is what life is about. And that's kind of what culture teaches you, you know, this story of every story has a romance in it. And I think romance is not the point of life. And romance is not always even, I don't even think you need romance in every story. I think that's just, even Christ says that in heaven we're not gonna be married, we're gonna be like brothers and sisters. So like to me, it's like the most important thing is connecting to each other as people. And even as men, I saw men, you know, I was taught that men only want one thing, and you know. So to me, and I saw it in movies too, you know, the girl would come and empower the man by pursuing him romantically and pursuing him, you know, sexually or whatever. And this was a powerful woman. She's kind of using this as a power over the man. She's not gonna let him get a hand up on her. She's gonna have the upper hand, you know? And so this is kind of how I felt. I thought that life worked. And I realized later on that this just animalizes men. That is not true. They are way more than just their sexuality and their romantic interests. And there's so much more to men than just that part of who they are. And we, you know, so often, and when I was growing up, I thought you're not mature until you've reached this place romantically. Like, you know, did you go this far? Did you do this? And that was always measuring, you know, your maturity. But maturity, that's just so, that animalizes us. You know, any ignorant animal can have sex. Right, you know what I mean? Right. So it's not about how far and all that stuff. It's about, you know, how can you use your freedom to choose to do the right thing in the face of all this wrong, to choose to honor and respect yourself and make it this precious, sacred exclusivity for your romantic life. We don't treat our romantic life the way animals do. I mean, we shouldn't ever think like compare ourselves to that. Oh, well, this is my desire, so I'm going for it. You know, that's not how we are wired. That's not how God made us as his children.
Lacey, one thing that a lot of women that I talk to that have gone through part of what you've gone through in your life, they have a problem relating to God as Father because yeah. of every man that they knew abused them or either physically, mentally, emotionally, whatever. How did you get over that?
Well, what happened was I ended up in an emotional affair with a married man, and that's what I talk about in the book. Mm-hmm. And in the middle of that, I thought 100% this is God, and this is the right thing to do. Yeah. And I was deceived. And when you're deceived, you think you're right. You would jump off a cliff for that. That's the thing about deception, is that it's not just that you're living a lie, because a lot of times you're living a lie, you know it. But when you're deceived, you don't know it. And when I realized after I had just pushed the Holy Spirit away and pushed people out of my life over and over again.
Now, you were a Christian.
Yeah, I was a Christian. Yeah, yeah. And I pushed all the good voices out of my life that loved me and followed voices that kind of encouraged what I was in doing. I ended up exactly in the place that I was when I first met God. And I was completely in, like, more close to suicide in that moment than I ever was. And so in that process, I remember God meeting me and miraculously rescuing me from suicide and knowing I had to end the relationship. And then I'm like, you know what? I don't know right from wrong. I can't tell. I can deceive myself. So I need somebody in my life that loves me for me, that has no ulterior motive, that can look at me and say, hey, Lace, this is not good for your heart. This is bad for your heart. You need to turn around. Don't talk to him anymore. You know? And I'm like, okay, I need that. And that's what actually opened my heart up to being vulnerable, to trust. And there was a man and his wife, a pastor and his wife, that God brought into my life as safe places. And you can't use your street mentality in pure love, or you rob yourself. Mm-hmm. That street mentality is for people who are trying to hurt you. But when they're trying to love you, if you still have that, you actually rob yourself from that thing that God wants to give you, that relationship of a father and a mother who are like, hey, I'm going to tell you the truth here.
Lacey, there's if anything I've gotten out of your books and even from your music, it's that you know who you are. I mean, it is powerful, the style of music that you use, the way that you write in your books, the way that you're able to minister to young ladies. You know who you are, and out of that foundation, you can change what I need another like 6 hours with you just to talk about you, because you've got to tell your whole story. But we've got to go. We've got Sydney is here with the Nightlife Scoop.
You know, sometimes the best place to begin to understand our identities is with our fathers, both spiritual and natural. And one little girl is getting a taste of that at a young age. Ron Alston starts every day by speaking positive affirmations and prayers over his 3-year-old daughter, Aaliyah. And his morning motivations have gone viral with more than 17 million views and counting. Let's take a look.
I am amazing.
I am amazing.
I am great.
I am great.
What's your name?
Aaliyah Alston.
If you fall,
I get back up.
What are you?
I'm blessed.
Yes. Say thank you, God.
Thank you, God.
For making me. The greatest.
The greatest.
Alston says his morning motivation is actually a tradition that started with his own father. And Tim, I just absolutely love that how he's speaking positively over his daughter at such
was
a
your,
young age.
Was your dad like that to you? Did he speak positively over
my
you?
My dad always spoke positive over me and always said, like, anything is possible, that I could do anything that I put my mind to.
I think every father's heart's cry is that their daughter would know that mm-hmm. they are amazing, they're beautiful, they're wise, they're strong, they're powerful, and that they are God's daughter as well. Very cool. Thanks, Sydney. That's a great story. I appreciate that. Guys, what is the news of the day? It's time for the news.
Ladies and gentlemen, you know what time it is. Kellen, tell them. Today is National Mario Day. And did you know in 1981, Mario the Italian plumber was first featured in the game Donkey Kong?
And in 1983, the Mario Brothers franchise began and has sold over 200 million copies to date.
Mario is truly the greatest video game character ever to be created.
Ladies and gentlemen, it is our privilege to have Lacey and Josh Sturm. Let's give it up for them. Thank you for doing one of my favorite songs of yours.
Thank you.
I tell you what, Lacey and Josh Sturm, ladies and gentlemen, what a gift. What a gift they are to the church. What a gift they are to the world. You know, as we were talking, everyone has two plans for their lives. There's one that Lacey found that was set for destruction, and then she also found the one that's set for destiny. In our culture, image is everything, and the image we believe of ourselves is the key to which of the plans we'll fulfill. Stephen Covey, author of the book, The Seven Habits of Highly Effective People, describes our image as either being personality ethic or a character ethic. Now, from a Christ-centered point of view, that is simply based on how we feel versus how other and others make us feel, or what we believe about the way that God sees us. See, God sees each of us as a success, as a blessing, as a joy. In God's eyes, we are His sons, and as Lacey has tattooed on her arm, daughters, whom He loves with an everlasting love. Regardless of how we feel about ourselves, we were made in the image of God. We're all fearfully and wonderfully made, and God doesn't make any junk. See, Lacey was broken by the failures of people. Her hopes and love were trampled to the ground. Her trust was broken, and often her understanding of who God loves, and completely it got twisted and broken by an experience that she didn't understand. Now, you may be similar to Lacey. People can be jerks, but God will never be a jerk to you. Right now, if you're going through something, you can call and talk to someone who loves the Lord and loves you and will pray with you. Just 888-665-4483. But please understand two very important things about God. One, He loves you with an unending love. And two, He has a plan for you, one that's for your good. Now, if you'd like to pick up some of Lacey and Josh's music or her books, you can find them at any bookstore, at Amazon, or at LaceySturm.com. But thank you for allowing us to bring a little light into your night. We'll see you next time on Night Life.
Tim,
what is it with you guys?
Where did Lacey go?
Well, she left. She must have saw you guys coming. I don't know, guys.
We're ready to rock, but why you got to bring
this
hat?
I'm not even sure.
But where is she, Tim? We're ready.
She's gone, guys. I think she might have seen. Where do you even find wigs like this?
The hair, the pants. Grandma had to make these pants, Tim. This is gonna be our big break.
Guys, you're really scaring me. You know what? I do counseling every Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday morning. We'll set something up. We'll help you figure out who you guys are, okay?
Okay, Tim. We appreciate it.